Kannada language. Kannada is a language for Karnataka, but right now we are doing it manually. And we've been looking for machine-assisted translations, and it's a huge problem for local languages in India. So does anyone have any suggestions on what we could do or how we could go about this problem of translating, of using local Indian languages on the internet?
Okay, so if I just want to clarify that we understand. You are part of an effort that is basically sharing local knowledge, maybe.
For them to be able to use the local language script on the internet to reply or to write. So we are facing a lot of problem because we did try it with Hindi, and even with Hindi we couldn't really succeed. So we're trying it with Kannada language.
You mean data entry tools to type?
Yes. No, they would type their response, right? It's all online.
Yes.
The knowledge sharing is all online. So say a farmer in Karnataka has a question about his crops, and he puts it online to all the other members of the community.
Correct.
And they respond. So right now it's all happening in English, but we would like to do this whole thing, replicate this model in local regional languages.
Okay.
So,
I mean, go ahead. Yeah, I have a specific answer, but go ahead. Yeah. I think what she's trying to say is there's some kind of bulletin board or chat type of read, addressing the typing and getting the information in originally, plus the translation aspect of it as well.
I mean, my approach would be to try to make whatever investment you make in terms of dictionaries and dictionaries of expressions that do not have to be changed for each word that's being said. So even though have essentially only one barrier, that is the time to look it up. If you're online, the lookup can be instantaneous. A text in another language, suppose they take one Indian language, but they speak another one. If we have a dictionary, an online dictionary is just like the one that has been built there, even if it is incomplete, we can build easily the software will enable people to just somehow get an idea if they speak some of the language. They can get an idea just with little help from the dictionary. And whatever investment is made in the dictionary is an ongoing asset. Whereas if you do the investment into the actual translation of the thing that was said, it is only linked to that specific thing. It cannot be reused so easily. So in terms of an ongoing investment, we can use that. And of course, the tools by which this is automatically proposed. So typically, you know, blogging software could very easily be extended to contain dictionaries by which the access could be facilitated. And you know, if I look at the lack of software that we see in this in this area, I'm sometimes really surprised why it isn't being seen more. I have an iPhone, for instance, and I see that, you know, one of the selling applications are the dictionaries, but the dictionaries are totally standalone. They're not integrated with any other stuff. There's no real gain, except that, you know, I can jump from one application to another. You know, it's probably still easier to go on a dictionary and paper. Just to wait maybe was saved. There's no special weight for it to carry a dictionary around. But the capabilities of online software in terms of finding an instant solution, maybe not the perfect one, but one of the advantage of coming immediately, that can actually change the situation for many people because they're much more intelligent than we usually take them to be.
And I can offer something specific, okay? I know of a gentleman who is 10, 15 years ago, he started a company. He's not at this conference. He's from Chennai. Young man. I think he came from a scheduled caste for local Indians. He's done very well. He's made 10, 20 million bucks, and his software is used for making websites and blogging. Now, I believe he has 400 banks around the world using it. Every bank user pays $1 a year. Okay, so he's making a lot of money. He's from Chennai. It's ISO 9000. It's won awards, Arthur Anderson Awards. He's got lots of languages. He's controlled a lot of the market around the world. He's reached the point a few years ago, he wants to do something for India. He's prepared to give this free. He's prepared to invest in Indian languages. He has it. He's talked to me about it, but he doesn't want to get involved in Indian politics. Okay, he's an Indian guy out of Chennai. I can give you the name. He is more than happy to make, you know, He has all the languages working, local languages. He's got blogging content and website development. Very good tool. He's prepared to give it free, but he doesn't want to get involved in it, you know, that this is his thing. And he'll even co-develop some stuff, for instance. So as far as the putting input stuff, maybe you can work with him. I can give you an introduction to him. The other thing is, he doesn't want any money from India. He's more than happy to just donate it, okay? And he's been giving it free to Afghanistan. He flew down there and gave it to them and some government thing 2 years ago. So he, number two is, if you worked with somebody like him and you're prepared to come up with a very simple dictionary working with a local university, Karnataka to English, we're talking about just 2,000 words. You know, we're not trying to do grammar, just word lookup. Simple list, get him to, as he says, you know, attach it to his blogging tool so you can do exactly what you saw on the web. You are far along the way already in trying to, because the farmer who asked the question has some idea of what the question is already. He just needs a few nouns translated and he can get the picture. Okay? Now the other alternative, which is if you can't wait for technical people to show any interest, is to use the usual people power. What I would say is you have a large farmer community. They wouldn't be using this if they're not getting something out of it. Okay, they're getting something out of it, which is why they're using a tool. Now, the fact that there are some people there already in this community who can do a bit of translation already between Kannada and English. Now, if you can find a way to empower them, money doesn't need to be it. It's incentive. It's credit. I'm the translator on the site. You get him, give him a few brownie points. You know, people will do things for free, believe it or not. You know, so you can maybe empower some of your community to actually somehow volunteer and get some status to get in there to translate some of this. In the interim, you know, they get something for doing this, some benefit for doing this. It's not necessarily money, but that may be a way to look into is what I would suggest. Because you're talking about a community now, and a community is a different issue. One last question on this issue.
It's just an expression of my feeling and my opinion about this region's subject. I think multilingualization is a way for local access to local culture. And I believe that local access needs some infrastructure. For example, the new TLDs, the IDNs, is one tool for this. And also the content and the tools that you had an exposure about the translation, for example. These are some tools only to get people the access to their new content, their content in their own language. But local culture cannot be translated, I think. Culture is a sensual thing. I think it's not a technical thing, I think. And what I mean here is that we have two steps here. The first step is to bring an infrastructure for the local access, for the people, for the local people. And in the second step, those people have to decide for their own aims for their culture, for the culture localization. I don't know if I could express my feelings clearly.
Do I understand correctly that you say that the localization?
I think that it's an expression of the culture. So just translating a content cannot translate the culture. Does it make sense?
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But the thing again is, I think it goes further than that even, is that if we go away from the concept of translating, you will find that people will make many contributions based on a translation and decisions made remotely, so to speak. We think that there is a demand for, you know, whatever, Persian localization of that software, of that movie. Fine, the decision is made by someone else. And as the people don't even think that they have their own ability to do things, they probably also produce much less. If they have more access, on the other hand, to the software or to the movie or whatever content that they blog, that they see, they try to understand in the foreign language, the more easily they will build stuff in their own language, and possibly the same tools that made it accessible in the foreign language to them could also be used to make their language accessible to others. without translation, but just help in getting to the meaning of the words.
Yes.
That's fine. All right. Sharap?
Yes.
Okay. Original organizer of this meeting. And let me just briefly pose that question. But before I pose that question, because it was generated by the original panel, the original panel actually included somebody from essentially the Prime Minister's office in China, where they have deployed some IDNs already ahead of ICANN. They have actually deployed full IDNs working in China. I'll discuss that in a few minutes. But so they were going to be here to talk about the Chinese experience a little bit. Then the other person was supposed to be the Russian ministry official responsible. Russia has taken a great interest in IDNs very recently in the last year, with Putin himself making statements and Medvedev taking statements, you know, about how important IDNs are for Russian culture and Russian. This was not at that level, say, even 2 or 3 years ago. And this is parliament actions there and so on. They've taken a great interest, so they've assigned much higher level ministry people, and they've started attending IGF and ICANN in the last year in a much stronger way. And the person who is now in that position, as being the top point person to the government on IDN issues at IGF and ICANN, was actually going to be on the panel, but they didn't turn up. Thirdly, the actual organizer of the conference was YJ Park, who was actually probably the first woman and first Asian who was on the first ICANN boards long ago, 10 years ago. And she was very instrumental in bringing, getting CCTLDs in Africa all online. At the time, there were no CCTLDs from Africa. She went around preaching everywhere from Korea. She's Korean. And she was very active, and some people in the IGF civil society community would say that some of her early activities helped, you know, nourish the effort towards the civil society movement within the internet. She was very early on. But in the last several years, she ended up working in getting a PhD with Milton Mueller, who's a professor at Syracuse, and she's now a professor in her own right at the University of in Netherlands. And she's also an advisor to the Korean, you know, internet community, to the government. And so she was, you know, instrumental in trying to put this together. She's not here either because the Korean delegation canceled totally. And then there was also Tan Tin Wee, Professor Tan Tin Wee is a colleague of mine. He helped together with me, but he was the principal lead, helped pioneer IDN back in 97, 98. He was also the head of the Asia-Pacific chairman many years, you know, before ICANN, for Asia-Pacific, to 30, 40 countries in the internet. He helped create APNIC a long time ago, APTLD, APRICOT. If you've been to those conferences, he was the original organizer, a lot of them. He was going to be here in the capacity of somebody from the National University of Singapore representing his views, you know, thoughts in IDN, essentially. And I think there's also one other speaker here supposed to be from Israel, who was the he is a domain name registrar there, but he's also been appointed by both his minister as an observer IDN, ICANN representative, essentially for Hebrew language IDNs, and he's been very active in the IDN community in ICANN, and he was going to be here to represent, you know, Hebrew developments. Anyway, so those were the kind of people who were originally here stated, and I think one of the issues, the main issues they were trying to address was, and that's the one I'll talk about, and I'll give you a brief history, and then I'll just open to the floor for any comments on this issue, which is that initially these IDN things, being a very small part of the need for internalization, I mean, there's content, there's all these other issues, there's no question about it, okay? But even with content today, in languages like Chinese, they have a lot of content. The problem is accessing it because the IDN isn't there. Okay, because you've got to type in English. So there's already a problem if you don't have the IDN for content, so in some languages. So IDN is a small but critical part of what needed to be done. And IDN, thanks to, you know, partly I was involved in the effort, but out of Singapore, it was pushed out and pioneered and in 97, 98, and 99. And by 99, ICANN declared a non-interest in it. They said, go learn English. Back then it was well documented. And so the Asians said, look, we'll be interested in Asia. And in Tinui's leadership, with my helping out, we ended up promoting it as a testbed for 1 year in Asian countries. You know, YJ was involved, some of the people in China were involved, 12 countries. India was not at the time that active. But then it was tested for a year, many, many workshops and conferences, and the technology was shared, the IDN technology. And eventually at the end of 99, there was a lot of regional interest. So what happened in 2000 was there were launches of IDN.IDN, full IDNs, the ones that we're talking about today. There were launches partly through my company, which was spun off from National University of Singapore, but in many places in China, Korea, Japan, India even, there was an attempt. Everywhere there were launches. And they were, and with ministers and so on in Taiwan, with a minister, and there are several hundred thousand domain names were registered at the time. But how did they work? Because ICANN did not take a leadership role. The way they arranged for it is by allowing the local few ISPs, you know, the top ISPs that control most of the market, to patch it at the local level so that, you know, it would resolve locally. And then there was plugins for those that weren't part of those ISPs, say smaller ISPs. This took off in many different ways back in 2000, 2000. It was well documented. If you Google it, you'll find 100 million hits, you know, different countries. And what happened is that in some countries it took off, and in some countries it didn't, as the internet bubble, you know, swept away. In India, it didn't really take off, you know. It was very back, you know, little number of users. But in China and other places, there was a real interest. Government got interested and took off. Eventually, ICANN got interested in this partly and came in 2003, 2004. The technology was standardized through IDNA at IETF, but still, ICANN didn't make the bigger move. You know, they kind of did something and didn't do anything. So then some countries decided that this was not going to happen, and they really had to worry about their culture and their own things. So China, in principle, in 2004 or so, they had a testbed working before that already, long before that. But they announced the law, and they said that as far as GTLDs are concerned, the ministry, Chinese GTLDs can only be operated in China with their approval, and that's it. And what happened is that soon after that, over the next couple of years, they worked with CNNIC, and they ended up issuing two TLDs that are like .com, actually three, one for China, one for something like .business.com, but it's Chinese characters, and one for .net. And this took off, and the way they solved it is by working with their local ISPs, and because they're all government-owned, and they patched a lot of them when they had 100 million users, okay? And this went on and was not really understood by ICANN abroad for a couple of years. But about a couple of years ago, people really discovered this, that it's been going on, and a few hundred thousand names have been registered. It works all over China. Hundreds of millions of people could use it, and this was happening. And so, and some of the people were aware of this. People in Arabia, 10 Arabic countries started testing and doing their pilots. In Israel, they had launches. You know, people who had launched in 2000 followed the Chinese lead and had different levels. In some countries in China, it was actually government-led. In some other countries, like Israel, it was run by the three ISPs. Two of them went along, and a couple of portals, phone companies, mobile internet. There's different degrees, you know, not 100% usability, but it went on, irrespective of ICANN. It was working, and there were sales, not lots, but it was happening around the world. Now, when the Chinese effort became very public, ICANN took a real interest again, 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, and said, look, we've got to do something here because people are beginning to do their own thing, and the Arabs are talking to the Chinese, and so on and so forth. So what has happened in the interim 2 years is ICANN has developed policy, both fast-track CCTLD policy that has taken so long that it might as well be slow-track, you know, and then GTLDs, and the GTLD sides, people made an improvement, and I was part of the GTLD effort at ICANN, and Werner was part of it, and a policy was developed a year and a half ago. Not everybody was happy with the policy, but it was developed. But the policy just sat for 18 months because we're waiting for the CCTLD side. So we're coming to some conclusion maybe in the next year or so. But what has also happened during this process is that some countries have taken a look at this and have said, look, the CCTLDs is fine, that, you know, every country is, you know, maybe will get what it wants. But they're also looking at the GTLD space, and they're saying the way the GTLD policy has been set up, officially proven, is leveraged so that you need $1 million or several hundred thousand dollars before you can apply, and the technical and financial barriers are very high. And so there's been lots of concerns from script communities, right? Countries and script communities that say, look, anyone can apply for these GTLDs. You know, anyone can apply from globally. Any company can apply for a language that is used primarily in one country, you know, perhaps. And that there's anyone can do, you know, the process is, you know, global, and the technical and standard barriers are so high, it's inconceivable that an Ethiopian government or an Ethiopian company could come up with all the technology or anything to protect their if you see, view it that way, it will end up in possibly in other hands that go for an Amharic or something. And so this is, and there's also a concern that in English, as you well know, in the last 2 years, speculation has come around. I mean, in the olden days, that when the internet got became popular in 97, 98, 99, you could buy a domain name like business.com for $100, and it was sold for $8 million, was the highest one. Then speculation became a bad thing, and all the domain name registrations decreased. Then 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, people discovered a new way of speculating on domain names through Google's advertising method. So single individuals with $500 went off, and this thing called domaineering has made them into, you know, one individual has become as worth $400 million just flipping these names. People who don't know any technology at all. And in fact, business.com came back on the market and was sold for $400 million as a single website, web domain, and that the person who bought it claims that he's already made the money over already. And this has happened with hundreds of millions of English names now, and a good number of them are worth a lot of money. And ICANN itself has changed its registration policy for many of the previous registries and the new registries, where the idea of keeping the charge very low is not gone already. So in fact, the latest registries that went ahead, .asia, did the whole thing on an auction model, the entire registry. So if two people applied for the same name during Sunrise, well, it's a runoff auction. So prices went to tens of thousands of dollars or more for even for .asia. So this is the new model now. You know, .mobi went off with $100,000. You know, when you know they sold 500,000 names or something for $10 or $20 on the first day they launched, but at the same time, 10 names were released, reserve names were released for, and they went for $200,000 a piece or something. So there's this whole huge money being made in English internet, and there's a whole bunch of people who made this money. I don't know, billions and billions of dollars, individuals, and you know, the industry, and these people are waiting with money to buy IDNs when they come up. Now, if these IDNs are launched by companies that don't have a vested interest in the local community, then the way the sales may be arranged may be quite different from the local community, if the local community took charge in the matter. We're talking GTLDs, I'm not talking CCTLDs. And so it could well be that, you know, someone, for instance, launches an Amharic domain, and there are not many people who use Amharic right now in Ethiopia and so on, and someone abroad just has a dictionary, Amharic people resident abroad or people who have dictionaries. They're online sites that, you know, names are being, you know, there are lots of people waiting with, and they will buy these names and eventually sell it back to the country at much higher prices, just like what they did in the English internet. So this is a real danger, and it's going to happen, it's already happening, okay? In fact, VeriSign launched a long time ago, multilingual.com, C-O-M, a million names were registered. It didn't work for a long time because of plugin requirements, but when IE7 allowed it 2 years ago, they revived and they're selling. And some of these IDN.com or IDN.jp, JP is Japan, is launched, and IDN.jp is run by essentially government forces in Japan, and Tokyo.jp is not allowed as a registration, but .com allowed Tokyo.com, a VeriSign allowed Tokyo in Japanese characters.com. Tokyo.com resolves today and was sold for $100,000 recently. That one single person in the West basically registered all 3,000 domain names that refer to every province in Japan a few years ago already under the .com. Under the .jp was not allowed. These are Japanese characters of Tokyo.jp. And he just sold one of them for $100,000. And you must understand, in Japan, when you name a company, you don't call it Mitsubishi Tokyo. Mitsubishi, you call it Mitsubishi Tokyo. You call it Mitsubishi whatever province. So it's the idea, Japan is a very systematic society. So it's very important for them to have things clustered around these 3,000 prefecture state names. So these are real issues, and it's already happening there, and it's waiting to happen all over again on the IDN.IDN world. So to get back to the central theme, so even though there's been a move towards these IDN GTLDs now at ICANN, and lots of people who've launched in their own countries are saying, look, we will seek IDN GTLD approval for abroad, you know, so that we get the local. While that is going on, there's been a worry that this is not enough. So, you know, for instance, the Chinese have already passed a law some time ago, and they're, you know, and the Koreans are debating a law, irrespective of ICANN. And there's even, today I heard that even the Sinhalese government may have some views about Sinhala, not Tamil, which is used by many countries, but Sinhala. You know, the notion is, so that, to get back to the question, nobody is saying, the technology is the same. There's no question of fragmenting the internet, it's just technology. The technology is identical everywhere. Not a single, that's my claim to fame, that the technology that we helped invent is now used, you know, in a modified form by every single person. The IDNA standard, no one is talking about a different standard. This is a huge success story in itself, because DVDs, we have four different versions, and we have, you know, driving on two different sides of the road. We have three different train gauges, you know, real train tracks, and so on. So it's an amazing success that with all these languages, we're talking about a single, you know, technology that everybody's using. It's simply whether we put the switch on, whether who's in control. That's the real issue, okay? So technology is out of the picture. Okay, so the real question then is, and nobody is debating that languages are effectively global, and you know, people should all share every language. That if just because I speak Tamil, I don't, it's not only in my interest to preserve Tamil, but everybody else in the world should help me preserve Tamil as well, and should participate in it. I don't think that's the issue either. But the question that up for debate is, And it's a very provocative question. And the reason it should be asked is many countries are looking at this now as a way to bypass this. I know of a couple of other countries that are looking at this. You know, in Korea, there's legislation going through the government right now. Okay, so you know, so some countries have done with ISPs as market commercial forces, but the government thinks that may not be enough, you know, to protect. So this is happening on the key languages. You know, Chinese alone, when China did this, half the truly IDN market is taken care of. I mean, what I mean by truly IDN is the Norwegians don't really need that much IDN. They're already well catered for, okay? So we're talking about, if you look at the truly IDN, that's about 700 million people on the internet today. About half of them are greater Chinese. So if the China has taken this rule, then it's half have already decided. Then there are a couple of other major blocks that are thinking about it. So if 7-8 big scripts go this way, then you're looking at, you know, quite a lot of it, you know, minor scripts will be left. But so the question is, the question that was one of the, in the minds of one of the couple of the organizers was that, to what degree is this the right, if, or, you know, a presumed right of a local community that speaks that language? Say in the instance of China, which says, you know, okay, I mean, I know there's Taiwan, but let's leave that aside. Let's just say 99% of the people who speak Chinese live in China, and there's a small number of people who live in the US and other places who speak China. Who, you know, language is an expression of people's, you know, identity and culture. Now, it is global, everybody will share this, but do the Chinese have special rights, you know, or different rights as a community to be able to say, you know, we will have some view on what GTLD string should be picked and not just decided by somebody else, and what language or what are the policies that we should we be the people who decide? One of the questions the Koreans asked during the GTLD process and then walked out of the process was they said, we should have a veto power on the GTLD strings in Korean that ICANN chooses to speak. And there was no, they said, no, that's not something that you should automatically de facto should have, even though it's pretty much spoken just there. So there's all these issues. And so the question, the provocative question is, how much, you know, what is the balance? You know, if there should be a balance, should local, forget even a government saying, hey, no way, you know, but the question is, how much does the local community have in that input while it's still a global, and I'm just gonna open this provocative question to anybody who wants to discuss this, because this is the real world, it's happening out there. Go ahead. The mic and the other half speak Telugu. Now, the interesting thing is this, and this is a great example to describe. The Urdu is related to Arabic and Farsi as a spoken language, but as a script, they did not use the Arabic script. They used some more Indian script. So here we have a situation where a language, this is a language where the script is used by a number of different languages, but then there's a subset of those languages. No, there's another language that is spoken in the same way, but actually uses a completely different script. So there's all these overlaps, okay? But a simple language is like Chinese. Chinese is only, you know, one script, one language, and then it pairs, okay? Well, that's not true, because there's Chinese, Japanese, Korean. Let's talk about something else that is much more straightforward. Tamil. Tamil, the language in what I speak, is only one script and one language. There's no overlap between the two. Go ahead. Well, it's not even working on it. I mean, China has passed a law that anybody who entertains running a registry in Chinese, you know, in Chinese character sets, I assume, in Chinese language, in Chinese character sets, dot Chinese something, you know, you can do it outside. They don't control anything that happens around the rest of the world. But if you're going to do it in China, you're going to operate this and sell or do or something, well, you can't do it without you getting the permission of the Ministry of Information Technology. And that's been since a law since 2004. It's on the website. It's been there. I mean, some people like ICANN know, but they ignore it. And I mean, it's true, it's there. And then other people are considering, because they felt that these communities have increasingly felt that they're not being listened to. So whether it's government or not, and they're trying their ways to, you know, some other ways have been, in the case of Israel, what they've done is they've tried to corner the market essentially in a way where their local ISPs, with the blessing of government, have gone and, you know, commercially launched these things and made it viable across the country with all the ISPs. So it kind of, you know, no one in his right mind would apply for a Hebrew TLD at ICANN who's not from that group, because simply because you can't outcompete these people locally. Yeah.
So just one question. So are we moving?
Has this artificial division that has came from historically, as I explained before, CCTLDs and GTLDs. Them and Dot Berlin, they're working, you know, melds the hose to keep that distinction separate. There was discussion, and there was at one point when Serb said, why not combine the two or something? But there was discussion, but they decided that what they would do is that every country that already has, in some sense, a .in or whatever in the local and in English characters, is some in some vague sense entitled to an equivalent in their local language, one or two or three. And that's what we're working on, either the slow track or the fast track process on the ccTLD side. But separately, on the gTLD side, which is the generic, the .com, the .net, remember, in the history of the internet, so far, the generics are much more successful. They have been, even now. They've been, I mean, the ccTLDs are beginning to catch up and all that, but the gTLDs haven't stopped. They're growing too. So in, given the former history, we know that there is a space for gTLDs in every country, in every language. You know, why not? I mean, why should it just be .in in India? Why can't it be a .gov in Indian or a ., you know, whatever, right? I mean, it's eventually could happen, right? So gTLDs is an important part of the equation too. And ICANN is trying to do both at the same time, although the gTLDs got ahead of it and got their policies. While I myself was on the committee and do not like some of the policies, that's what got agreed to, and the policy's been waiting for the ccTLD process to work. But there's nothing to stop on the gTLD side for, you know, anyone to go ahead when the process starts in a year or so, 9 months or so, is the time frame, to go ahead, put up their hand and apply for a gTLD. For instance, the Chinese government has launched, after doing the common net, they did .gov and .org, and they've asked 1 million of their state-owned companies to register. 200,000 have already registered in the last couple of months.
So that's where .go...
Whose translation? But
.cat is Catalano? Is it for the language
okay.
area?
Catalan is... New gTLDs were introduced, .biz, .info, and .museum, and a few others. Some of them are community-based, and they're successful. Small gTLDs for, you know, museum and so on, okay? 30,000, 50,000, that's what's successful. But the gTLDs that were more .name, .info, they were more commercial, there are a couple. I think most people would say they have not been terribly successful, 1 million or 2 million names or 4 million names and not really being used. You know, .com is still, you know, really, you know, continued to grow much faster, okay? But at the same time, there was a move by people who said, look, ccTLDs is artificial. We are a language group. We are the Catalan community. We're not represented. We are across a few countries. There are not too many of us. And they spearheaded this idea, and they broke a lot of ground by getting ICANN a few years ago to agree. I mean, they went through a lot of grief. And eventually to say hundreds of thousands of speakers, no more than that. Or maybe more. Maybe
10,
more.
10 million.
Oh, sorry. Then I'm completely wrong then. But they talk about, what, a 50? What is the number of .cat registrations now, 100,000?
No, 30,000.
30,000. But it's for a community that's spread all over. It's like, for instance, like the Kurdish, you know, they're all over the place, right? So they ground set this thing. Then soon after that, European Union said .eu. We are kind of a country, so .eu happened. And also, there's been talk of .arab, as in not a country, but a language, a linguistic thing, just like .catalan. Okay? So there's talk, but what's really gotten, you know, has actually launched, and so on and so forth, has been what? .cat? .eu, which is extremely successful, and .asia, right? Has there been any other community, you know, non-country?
Not yet, because unfortunately, the generic top-level domains that were introduced and continue to be introduced by rounds, it is a situation where everybody has to wait until the round is finally announced. Then you have to run to try to get it through in whichever conditions that may be. And then you have to wait again for ICANN to process it.
Yeah.
And then you have to wait again for the next round to happen.
Yeah. And
right,
the prices have gone up.
Each.
Mm-hmm. The prices have gone up from $20,000 to now maybe several hundred thousand it might cost you to go for one. And it's insane. But there's 7 days for comment, and then it's over. 400 pages that not many people I even know have read it. That's the state of things. And I can assure you, Sharam was on the committee over there from Persia, Iran, and Werner was in the original policy committee, and many views were made in the International Bank. But on the other hand, you know, I'm sure they're good Amharic, you know, Ethiopian banks. They're good enough as far as that country is concerned, but there'll be nobody to be able to say this is a good bank because there's no international panel that, you know. So, but unfortunately, the response was, you know, ICANN at the time, two responses. One, nobody cared. Secondly, lip service. The other response was that how could ICANN possibly go to all these countries and do all these things? But, you know, you get $100 million, they're charging $200,000 application fee. I mean, well, you know, the point is either you do it or you don't, right? I mean, and so but those are the kind of statements that were made. And so now we're in a situation, and one of the things that was asked at that time was that the IDN policy should be separated from the new English gTLD policy. But for convenience, they combine the two. So now, there are people out there who have seen the money in the English GTLDs and are willing to pay $1 million, $2 million, $3 million to acquire a new GTLD because they can sell off the good names for a lot of money as straight auctions. So at this moment in time, since the door is being opened for both at the same time, nobody's complaining that hard because the people with this new round of English GTLDs, they understand they make a lot of money. They're no longer complaining about the fact that it's no longer 20,000 that much. Why? Because several hundred thousand, they're saying make it higher because that cuts out competition for them. But unfortunately, the IDNs are being dragged at that same level. So what's happened is we're being set, the IDN community is being set to a bar that is much higher than even actually, some of the technical requirements that they're asking for the new GTLD round, I believe even the very science of this world haven't quite met yet. There are new things they're asking that have to be developed. So you're setting this bar so high, you know, in many different ways, and so many ways, and the money, and so on and so forth. It's actually, instead of affirmative action, what has happened is complete the opposite. In fact, I can, Rajesh, who I hope is, maybe he's in the room, he can confirm. Rajesh came up to me, our host, and he said, you know, the last time when this was announced, the actual fee is 200,000 plus at least 700,000 cost to estimate to apply. He came over and he said, the comment he made to me and a number of others, was, it costs $1 million to apply for a GTLD just so that we can put one line of code in the root server. And he was just joking. It's just, there's no money in some countries right now. And so maybe a local operator would not be interested, but a foreign operator would be. This is the risk. And this is, and as an inventor of IDN, this is not something I had hoped would happen, okay? Because it's reverse colonization. As Avri, the head of the GNSO, when I described this to her 2 years ago, she said, this is reverse colonization. So it's not surprising that some of these countries that are aware have watched, they have decided that, maybe this is not enough, and they're beginning to consider taking their own internal action like the Chinese. And anyway, this is certainly, going on. And my question, again, to get back to it, is not that this isn't happening. This is documented, even though not well publicized, because even my own personal opinion here, even this workshop that was put together, there were forces active to kill this workshop because we were going to say things that certain forces who fund this IGF a lot were not interested in hearing. So, but it's out there, it's been going on for 12 years, but it's out, it's real, okay? So the real question I'm asking is, I don't know the answer. How much should, because I'm part of the overseas community of Tamil. I'm not living in Tamil Nadu, I'm not living in India. So I don't know how much influence I should have or a foreigner should have on the local language or should, so this is a real question. And, and I would be very much, and I think the original organizers would be very much interested in hearing if there are any, I can see an Arab contingent in the back there, I can see some Indians in the room, whether, how they feel about how this language space should be shared in terms of defining, I don't mean government regulation, that goes way out there, but I mean in terms of shaping and deciding, for instance, if somebody, just to be totally provocative, if somebody decides to apply for a TLD, okay, it's not someone who's Arabic, but someone who's not so happy with Arabs, goes and applies for an Arabic TLD, and then starts allowing the registration of domain names that are not very nice, to the Arabic community, maybe religious or not or whatever, and allows that to happen, is that something that the Arabic community can say, look, this shouldn't happen? I mean, what, because, this is the thing that people are concerned about, and the Koreans are concerned that a Japanese company will take over this thing and shape and influence where it goes. Right? Yeah. Oh, sorry, it's pretty late. Okay, sorry, yeah. So, just a few thoughts. Anybody in the audience from native, ethnic? Go ahead.
In language, then I will answer your question.
Speak up.
You all have this map in your hand. In part of the map, the name of India in 22 official languages are written. Three of these languages, Kashmiri, Sindhi, and Urdu, are in Perso-Arabic script. I can read them, but these are not my language. So I think this is a good example for the relation of the script with the language. And secondly, for your question, I believe that a community has a priority to decide for his related TLD language, for example. But necessary, it might not be strict. I think everybody can have access. Everybody who has an interest to a language can work on that language. But it might not be a necessity. I think a community who speaks the language has a better sense on that language and can be a better decider for that language.
A parallel case, I understand that, but I believe that ICANN was quite active to protect, or I'm trying to choose my language rather carefully, that if you had a trademark, you could claim a special interest in that particular form of letters. Before I came here, I did some research for something Diplo was doing on Welsh. Welsh isn't using a different script, it's using Latin script, but .cym in Latin script for Welsh means Welsh.
Yes.
It also apparently belongs via the ISO to the Cayman Islands, which creates a difficulty if both of them want it. Again, I'm not sure, but it seems to me that perhaps the popular rather than the economic interest would support the people who are supporting a language claim or a group claim of some sort of culture over the money way of looking at things. And I'm hoping very much that what's happening in the world at the moment might persuade us that the money way of looking at things
Correct.
Is not always the right way to go.
Absolutely. No, I want your TLD. But essentially, whatever you, the criterion you analyze, it ends up being one that you can win by money, essentially, not by by something else. And it certainly does take people to make comments. So there's a few days left to make comments for the applicant's guidebook in English, but certainly suggest that people read it and make comments to that process.
And there is an initiative, I don't know whether it'll take off, but to get a petition, one-page petition. Previously, comments in form IGF, ICANN, whatever, but I think certainly ICANN, during comment periods, we get very few comments, hundreds of comments, and that's it. And it's very easy for these organizations to say, well, that's just 100 and take it care and move on. And the argument always is we are representing the 100 million computer internet users and forget all the 100 people with the comments, right? But the issue is that but if we can get a petition where you get 100,000 people to click it, that's a different story. I think maybe that message might be heard. It's not clear, but you need an issue. Maybe this is the issue to drive back. And there's some effort, but it requires a lot of effort, and that's one thing. The other thing I want to say is regarding ICANN is that you're right absolutely about this, because the money and stuff in ICANN, in the IDN case, was trying initially in the GTLD process to push the rights of trademark holders to say that as long as you already own a trademark, say, .IBM in English, right? Say you own IBM, and now somebody's going to launch a .IBM. Well, that's fine in English to go to IBM. But the word IBM in Tamil should also be reserved for them, even though they may not have actually registered the IBM in Tamil characters in trademark in Tamil Nadu and paid for it. If they have, fine. But you see, so there's that. And then the issue of if you already have Canon, because they're a global brand, that domain name automatically kind of belongs to you in all the languages. This was the move they were initially pushing. It's been watered down, but it's, on the TLD side, it still heavily favors it. It took a lot of effort to even water that down a bit, because there's this belief that somehow 30,000 global corporations or 40,000 global corporations, because they're global, they have a right to every language. See, the whole issue of the nub is, does language take precedent? Or does globalization take precedent? The idea in English, is that more important? Is the concept of bottle, if I've already patented the idea of a bottle, do I own it in every language? Or does the idea of language take precedent? This is a very interesting question that has to be decided by society. But unfortunately, because the control, and as Werner points out, the control and money favors the group. And the group that is from the multicultural end of it is disorganized and weak. and it's unable to, you know, has its own divisions within it, so it's unable to address this as effectively as perhaps it can. Now, one last question perhaps, and then we will call it a day, I guess.
Actually, what is to be? For example, leave alone the Amharic, as an Amharic script, in English also, for example, if you just go to addisababa.net, then it says something is written inside and it says, this page is under the cell, and if you want to contact, then click this. Yeah. This type of issue are actually existing, and the forum like this one is supposed to also help, actually, to take some measures to give some right, not directly, but in a way, to advance some people. I mean, like Ethiopia might have started some advancement right now, and we don't need to lose everything what is supposed to be to the country, because we are actually starting late. And that is my comment actually on this.
This was considered bad, well regarded, and it's considered a real business. It's no longer called speculation, it's called investment. And those are the people from that community are the ones who are really going to be applying for the new GTLDs, most of them, okay? And they made a lot of money, and it's considered, it's there are business schools in America that teach this now. I mean, it's considered okay, you know? There are books called Real Estate for Internet Dummies, you know? I mean, Internet Real Estate, buy, get $100,000, invest in domains, and make a lot of money. And it's a huge industry, it's happened, and it's, my own estimate is over $1 trillion. Domain names today in English are worth over $1 trillion by my estimate. And the fear now, as you rightly point out, is that it's going to be, for those who don't look after their own languages, whatever, I mean, that's why these people are acting. It could end up going to those languages, and worse, even if it happens within your own country, if it happened by foreigners, at least if it happens within your country, somebody buys it and sells Addis Ababa in Amharic to somebody else, well, you know, it's all local money shifting hands. At least it's that, you know, but now it may be that foreign countries, you know, I mean, you know, people who have no real relationship to that community, they're just sitting there, to be, you know, from abroad. So these are real issues, but there's no real voice to speak, and we're very close for it to happen. We're very, very close. It's, you know, the policies have been set, and a lot of this is going to happen. It's out there. And I know, you know, you know, we're trying, but it's not effective. But, you know, and I guess that's the reason why some countries have decided to think in these different ways locally to somehow protect their interests. And anyway, Wena, you wanted to say something, and then I guess we have to call it a day. It's late.
Well, I think there's only one remark. Look at the new GTLD and the fast track documents, and try to submit comments within the timelines that we have been given. There's only a few days left, and it's important that these comments that you have are seen publicly.
Okay, I guess thank you for staying an extra hour. I guess we started some late too, 45 minutes late. So thank you, and hope you have a pleasant stay in the rest of the conference.
Lift that adapter.